Give me just a second here to tick all the right boxes. There we go. Okay. So welcome everybody, I'm Barb Owen, and this is Friday, otherwise known in my place as Drama Free Friday. We call it that because there's nothing we can do about the craziness going on in the world. Absolutely nothing. It's going to go crazy, and for the next 2 hours, 2.5 hours, whatever, we can't do anything about it, so let's just relax. And, sorry, I had to adjust the microphone. Let's just relax and just have a good time. What do you say, right? So we're going to let all the... I do all my little, you know, things. I chair dance, but I don't do that very well. So we're just going to do our little gyrations, and we send all the bad juju stuff out the window, and we just let it be out there for a while. Because while we're here, hi, Cindy. While we're here, we're just going to just enjoy and just have a pleasant afternoon, right? Right. So Drama Free Friday, and I'm glad you're here. Thanks for joining me. All right, so I have some show and tell, so we're going to do that real quickly. First, so last week I was doing things with mandalas again, because we were doing, you know, like we have all these mandalas, what are we going to do with them, right? So I thought, oh, we got to do something. And so I thought, well, I'd show you this, because I was... just giving you ideas last week and not doing anything that was terribly finished. And so I thought I would let you see what I ended up doing with the book. So I made a belly band for this book. And here is the book. There is what it looks like. It is stitched together with the Coptic stitch binding, which I was fumbling through last week. Just fumbling through it, just simply because I hadn't reviewed my own stuff. And that is against my policy. I should always review, but I didn't. And that tends to be a stitch that you don't necessarily remember unless you review it first. Anyway, so here is the mandala that I did on watercolor paper with Inktense pencils. And then I cut it in half. I like how when you open the book, you get to see the whole mandala again. And when it cuts, you know, when it's in half, it makes a taco book or something. And then inside, all the pages lay flat, which is the advantage of using a Coptic stitch binding. And also it opens up, each page opens up to be a full circle. So that's pretty fun. So I thought I would show you that. This is how it looks between the signatures. And then there, I think I put 3 pieces of watercolor paper in each signature, so there's 6, you know, 6 pages make up, there's 3 sheets make up the signature, but you end up, so there's 3 full pages, but you end up with 6 surfaces, if that makes any sense. So anyway, there's another signature. And I think I did 1, 2, 3, 4, I did 6 signatures, but you can see how it kind of wants to fan open, and that's kind of the nature of, if you don't get the tension exactly right with your Coptic stitch, it can do that. But also because it's watercolor paper and it doesn't want to fold, you know, super... hi, Joyce. Oh, thanks, Sherry. I'm glad you like it. So that's why I made the little belly band, just to slip over it. And besides that, it looks cool. So there you go. I mean, if it functions and it looks cool, how much better could it be, right? This, in case you don't know, I should show you this. This is a paperweight. This is my paperweight on my desk. So since I'm not weighting anything down, we'll just move that off so I don't knock it off and do something crazy with that. And this was the other thing I showed you last week. I'm just going to flip through it again. Hi, Susan. Thanks. I'm going to flip through this very quickly. This was a card I made for my husband, but I just thought I would show it to you. Another thing we did, this is just a little review from last week. Another thing I did using some of the mandalas that I had drawn, and then I scanned them or took photographs of them depending on the size, and then incorporated them into a card book. This is the card, the first book from Kyla's One Page Wonder class. He absolutely makes out like a bandit in June, because the first thing we have is our anniversary. The next, a week later, exactly, is his birthday. And then a week or 6 days or whatever, usually somewhere about that later, is Father's Day. So he makes out like crazy. So it was his birthday this week. And so another one of the things that Kyla, I watched the video once while I was doing something else, but it was in one of the class videos. She wanted us to do something with matte paper, I believe. It's been a few days that I've slept since then, okay, people? I've slept since I watched the video. I think this was one of the assignments, but I couldn't tell you for sure. Anyway, he loves maps. My husband loves maps. And so I took a page out of an old atlas that I had, made the same little structure, and then made a birthday card out of it using kind of the map theme. So this is the card I made very late at night the other night. You started here, and then you went here, and here, and then here, and here. It just took a lot of brain power, people. It took a lot of brain power, okay? Hi, cheeky girl. I just saw your name pop in the chat. And here. And here. And now you're here. It's the perfect place to be. Happy birthday. And so that is his birthday card, which incorporated the map thing and the, you know, the you are here kind of thing and blah, blah, blah. Anyway, I thought it turned, I think it's kind of clever, but I don't know. It could have been that 1 a.m., 1:30 a.m., you know, thing of I got to get something done because I need something for him. And it kind of killed two birds with one stone. If, in fact, I heard Kyla say the right thing. But, you know, like I said, I've slept since I watched the video. So there you go. So I thought that's review from last week. Okay. This week... In the mail, I got the most adorable, look at the envelope, the most adorable, you guys are too good to me. This is from Zandra. She's in the chat. I gotta keep my throat wet. You think it's clever, Joyce? Okay. Thank you, Penny. Pardon me while I drink in front of you, but I gotta keep the throat wet. The throat wet so I can keep talking to you. Anyway, this came from Zandra, and I will tell you, Zandra listens to everything. Zandra doesn't miss a trick. I tell you, she doesn't miss a trick. She had it all tied up in this pretty ribbon, which matches the boys. She listened, of course, to the fact that we were motorcyclists at one point in our life. So this vellum paper is all motorcycle, different shots of motorcyclists. Mardi, hello. Nice to see you pop into the chat. I'm so glad everybody's here. Thank you so much for coming. And and then there was a beautiful doily wrapped around it, paper doily. Xander doesn't miss a trick, I'm just going to tell you. So here is the one page. We'll turn it over and look at the other page. Okay. Look at this. Now, this is all about motorcycles. So she used the same paper, the vellum paper. And Xander's here so she can correct me if I missed it. Good deal, Meredy. Keeps her confetti in her pockets. Mm-hmm. That's right, Sherry. She doesn't miss a trick. She doesn't miss anything that anybody says. So in here, she took that vellum and she cut it up and used that and slipped it in the pockets. And then everything on here is all motorcycle related. We didn't ride Harleys, but it doesn't matter. It's adorable. This is, I don't know where she finds things like this. This is very elaborate. I don't know what you call these things. Xander can tell you what this is. I don't know what this, what you call these when you buy these things that you can stick on things. I'm not, hi Linda. I'm not so much of a scrapbooker, and so I don't know, ephemera, is that what you would term this? It's beautiful. It's got all of the metal and it's amazing. And then she's got things on here. It's not the destination, it's the journey, the people and places, Harley Davidson, American tradition, rolling sculpture, touring, which we did. We did a lot of touring. Hi, Jean. Bit of trivia. I'm a licensed motorcycle driver myself. I used to ride my own bike and we rode all over the country. This feels like a tire, okay? It's from your stash, Xander. Why would you have this beautiful thing in your stash? You used to do tear bear bikers. Oh, how funny. How funny. Oh, that's amazing. Xander's in the chat, which if you're watching this on YouTube or as a recording, I'm talking to people in a live chat. We have a bunch of guests here today also. So if you would like to sign in, it's free and then you can chat with us. So it's a Jolie 3D sticker. Okay, cool. Now I know what that is. That is amazing. I wish you could see the, can you see the dimension of it? I probably not, but it's something. And this looks just like a motorcycle tire, I have to tell you. And the emblems up here, live sure, ride hard. So it's very cool. And then she's got Harley Davidson. This must be from paper or something. Maybe it's from this that she glued on the edging of the pocket page. And then we go to the other side, okay? So we go to the other side. And on this side is all about kitty cats. And enclosed with this was a Balzer Bits mask, kitty face mask. And she said that she couldn't wait to see what I did with that. Is that not the cutest thing? I'm teaching all day tomorrow. I teach paste paper and jelly plate, paper and fabric on jelly plates and paste paper. So I think this will probably have to make its way into my class supplies for tomorrow. I have not seen that one with the kitty face. It is so cute. And this was her card that she put in, like the little tear bear. Scraps to Beauty by Xandra. And Xandra streams on Wednesday night, I think about 8 Eastern, is that right? It's the zip strip from the paper. So this is the zip strip. I don't even know what that is, but that's the zip strip from the paper. I'm assuming it's on the edge of the paper. I'm not real familiar with scrapbook papers. I have some, but you know, I tend to go in and look at the colors and buy the colors I like or the things that I want to have for something, for some specific purpose. I don't go buy collections of things. So, you know, yeah. Anyway. Okay. So on this side, okay. Now, Xandra, if you made this, you did this real well. She enclosed all of the little confetti bits. They're like holeless beads, I think, in here. And there's a kitty dreaming of mice. So there's a mouse up there and a mouse down here. If you made this, you did a great job because it is fully encapsulated and did not explode. Hi, Lori. And we know how much Barb hates stuff, that little roly stuff. So you did a great job. There's a little heart charm that says love. There's kitty print ribbon. The detail on this is staggering, staggering. So I'm gonna go through these real quickly so as not to belabor the whole thing. And the stickers, food, it's a can of cat food that's open. Here, kitty, it says on that. I have not opened this other than I found her note and I read that and then that was it. So we're gonna see this together, live and in person. So let's see. These are little kitty paw print brads. Good grief. Kitty brads, paw print brads. And on this side is, it's a Harley Davidson, I don't know what. Something. What is this? Soft tip darts, steel tip, and soft tip darts. I don't know what that is, but it's cute. Cute. All right, so we're gonna put this all back together. I'm gonna try and keep this in order. So I'm gonna put the, and the paper clips are cool as well. She sticks things, she fills the pockets full, and then she puts things on the outside. It's pretty incredible. All right, I'm not gonna worry too much. So she's got, and then she has a little thing here with the teeny tiniest envelope in the entire world, and it says the letter. That is tiny. That is seriously tiny. Forgot to take the price off. I don't care. Doesn't make one whit of difference to me at all. So her letter, she has kitty tape, even leopard tape. And so her letter is all in here, which was really cool. Sealed up with kitty tape even. So the letter, but look at that, the letter. That is the cutest thing. I don't care whether you forgot to take prices off or whatever. It makes no, never mind to me. One time I gave a wedding gift to somebody and left the price tag on because I had somebody else wrap it for me. Uh-huh. It's like, which, if you were wrapping a wedding gift for someone else, you know, to help them, wouldn't you have taken the price tag off? Good grief. A wedding gift? Come on, people. Anyway, so here is one of her tear animals with a tear mouse. So this is one of my Siamese cats. I'm going to say that this one is Chance, and because he's skinnier, and the other one is Charlie. That's what I'm going to guess, because Charlie's fat and Chance is not as fat. So, yeah. Okay. Whoops. I left all the stuff in the pocket. He tried to put yellow in there for you. Great. Excellent. You did a great job. Great job, Xandra. So these are, I'm going to guess, are stickers. I'm going to have to do something with these stickers. These will be fun. These are all Harley stickers. How fun. Those are great. Yep, so I have ridden my personal motorcycle all over the United States and into Canada. Yes, this is Chance. Okay, it looks like him. All right, so then the next section. We'll see what's in the next section. She has adorable little kitty. I don't know what these are. I wish I knew the right names for things, but I don't know. They sure are cute. And so, oh, more stickers. How could you have that many stickers, Xandra? How could you have that many stickers with all these little kitty things? I'm telling you. Keep calm and put the kettle on. Oh. Pure green tea. So there's the tea bag. Lovely. Lovely. Hello, JZ. And then this one. Oh, ribbon. How funny. You even found ribbon with motorcycle things on it. Wow. Is that ribbon or tape? It looks like it might be tape. Xandra can tell us. I don't want to take it apart. I'm not going to take it apart. I'm not. How could you take this apart? How could you use it? I know you're supposed to, but Jan told me I had to plant the flowers. I still haven't done that, and I know I'm in big trouble for that. Big trouble. Hi, JZ. So down here under Charlie, and the kitty cats are wonderful. They are wonderful. So there is a sticker down here, and it says, there are two kinds of people in the world, Harley riders and everybody else. That is true. That is very true. That is entirely true. And there's a little emblem down here that says meow. And these are M-E-O-W. So there's meows with little kitties. And And then in this pocket, we got two more pockets to go here. In this pocket, oh my goodness, oh my goodness. There are, wait, I have to show you these up close. Give me a second to zoom the camera in as much as it'll zoom. Okay. I'm gonna try to hold these, get the reflection off of them. They are the teeny-tiniest little buttons ever. There's little kitties. I know, it is picking up a reflection off the light. I don't know if I can show these to you so that it will, so you can get the full impact. Cause they're so tiny. There's fish bones, there's kitties. These are the tiniest buttons I've ever seen. And there's a mouse. Okay, I don't know whether you can see those or not. Okay, there's my hand. I have zoomed this camera in as far as I can zoom it. And my hand, and you see how tiny those are. Are those the funniest, cutest little things ever? Ever. I don't know where you get things like that, Zandra. I truly, truly don't know where you find stuff like that. I mean, they are the tiniest things ever. Tiny. Goodness sakes. And then there's another one of these things with the little beads all securely contained inside, like water. Can you see those moving in there? I know the lights flash and everything out. See those? If you made that, that was a great job. It's a great job containing all those little rolly bits. And then there's more of these that I don't know what these are. Wait, I have to get one out. Okay, what are these? Okay, they open up. They really are darts. Dart products. Good night, nurse. They really are darts. Zandra, I don't know where you get things like that. It's a set of three dart wings. Okay. One for the end of a dart. For the end of a dart. Ah, thank you for telling me, Janet. So it's for the end of a dart. Cool. From the dollar store? How do you find stuff like that? It's amazing. And then there's kitty. I don't know if it's tape or if it's from the end of the paper or from the edge of the paper. Anyway, it is adorable. Adorable. A little mouse with little whiskers. Zandra, you are so kind. Thank you so much. You are very, very kind. I'm not going to try and put this back on. I'm just going to set it to the side because it was wonderful and I just love it. And thank you so very much. Zandra she has so much imagination. I'm telling you. That pirate book that she made for the baby book, ugh, adorable. So, Zandra, if you want to put your link in there, in case you didn't, for the end of darts. Interesting. See, I didn't know that. If you want to put your link into your Ustream, please feel free to do that. And she streams on Wednesday nights. So that was so sweet. Thank you again. Okay, so switching gears. Over the weekend, last weekend, we went to Art in the Park. Absolutely thumbs up. It was great. So last weekend we went to Art in the Park, which is an art festival in our community. And this is the paperwork, you know, the propaganda that they hand out, which is wonderful because you can look through and you get to see, you know, a little bit blurb. Well, you get to see the name of the artist, where they're from, what booth they're in, and a picture of their art. So I wrote a blog post about that, and you can find the blog post on HowToGetCreative.com. Nope, wrong one. Sorry, that's email. So you can find the blog post on HowToGetCreative.com under blog. So there's a blog post there about art in the park. And it was really, really interesting to go there. And so, you know, one of the cool things you do when you're there is you pick up, or I do, I pick up business cards when it seems appropriate. This is really cool stuff. This one, a lot of you will really like this. Look at that jewelry. I mean, her jewelry was just amazing. Beautiful mixed media pieces. Beautiful things. And this is albncollections.com. ALNB collections.com. So her name is Allison L. Norfleet Brunger. No wonder she abbreviated ALNBcollections.com. Yeah, so very cool. Very cool stuff. But that's a great thing about going to an art festival is you get to see all these very cool things that they have. So some people had postcards that they used as their business card. And so it doubles, you know, they can send it because it's actually a bona fide postcard. So they can actually send it in the mail or use it to hand out at the festivals. So this was the same person that I just showed you. And just beautiful work. Absolutely beautiful work. And this was fun. This one was fun. Don't become famous for doing something you don't like. And so this, I guess, is the business. But they had, everything was done on terracotta plaques. And they had them all up. And I was sorely tempted to buy some of those. They were really great. I resisted because I was looking. I wanted to see everything. So we toured the whole thing. And it was hot. But it wasn't as hot as it was the next day. And as we were looking around, I found one of the booths that was so interesting to me was this one, which is about using recycled metal. They recycle pop cans and things like that, or soda cans, or whatever you want to call them, tin cans and so forth. And they make all of these. It was called American Forging. And they make everything out of metal. So they had different kinds of dishes. They had different kinds of things. Now, my attraction to this was because it was a bookmark. And I love books, and I can't ever have enough bookmarks. And no matter how many I have, I still have books with the corners turned down on the pages. So anyway, I included information about this, and they handed out little information about what they do in their, you know, anytime you purchased anything. So on that same blog post that about art in the park, there are also a couple of videos on their process, and then I gave you a link if you want to go and see the other videos. There were like 5 videos. They're very short. Some of them are only just, you know, like 17 seconds or 30 seconds long, but I didn't have room in the blog post to post them all. So there's a link there. You can see 2 of them. And then there's a link that takes you to their YouTube channel so you can see the rest of them to see the process. It's really cool. This process is called Repoussé. Now, if I butcher the word, please forgive me. Thanks, Cheryl. It is where they make the form out of steel, and then they take this metal, which is the recycled stuff, and they put it in there, and they hammer it into the form to take on all the detail. And so I have no idea how long it takes them to make the form to start with, but I'm sure it's a long time because it's all done with hammer and chisel and everything, as far as I understand, to create the design. And then from there, then they can use that design over and over. Now, I'm assuming that it, thanks, CB, I got it right, huh? I'm assuming that it takes, that after a while, the form would wear out. But it's a hammered metal product. I know that I've done some of that with jewelry in the past also. But anyway, thought I would show you what I bought. actually, Claws Man bought it for me. It was, this bookmark was $9, which I thought was not bad at all for something that is made by American craftsmen. And they have to be made one at a time. They're not, you know, factory line, you know, whatever you call that, assembly line. Yeah. So it's really cool. Hi, Carrie. So I thought that was really neat. And so if you want to read about my experience of going to the art festival, you can see that on the web under blog. It's HowToGetCreative.com under blog, the tab blog. So I thought I would share that with you. And then I want to share these magazines with you. I shared this with you before, a few weeks ago. This was the first issue of Live Happy, this magazine, that I had ever seen. I bought it in the grocery store, and it was $6, $5.95 to be exact. And I liked it so much that I got a subscription to it. And so this was the next issue that just came. And so this is the cast of Good Morning America. I have not started reading this one because I'm not done with this one. And I want to finish this first. But it is rare for me to go through a magazine and highlight things and, you know, note things. And there is not a single page in here that I've read that I haven't done, that something important to me hasn't just leaped off the page. And on top of that, the artwork on the cover is pretty cool. You know, here's the, what do you call those guys? Ah, just went out. They ride motorcycles. Scooters, not motorcycles. You guys will know. Oh, there is a race man. Oh, there it is. And yeah, the other thing that this did, let me back up for a minute. You got the idea about the magazine. I recommend this magazine. You can never have too much positivity in the world. Let me back up a second since he put that link in there. The other thing that was very, very cool about this experience at Art in the Park was they had this entire, I don't know, my brain just blipped out for a second for some reason. They had this entire section for children, this humongous section for kids. And they had all these things for children, encouraging them to be creative and get their hands into it and do all kinds of fun stuff. And so they had face painting, they had bottles where the kids could put layers of colored sand in it. They had t-shirt painting, or t-shirt, must have been tie-dyeing. They had art and science in one booth. And they had all kinds of things with the children. And to see the excitement of the kids in that environment where so many of the fine arts programs are going by the by in our public school system, it just, you know, it really touched me. And it made me excited about children and art. And so that spawned a whole new thing that we're going to play around with today. So I'm glad he put that link in. Thank you for doing that. So that is what we're going to be talking more about for the next couple weeks. And then, I know we're a little bit here and there today, but and then I got this brand new magazine. I don't know. Yes, they do. Di, I want to tell you something. Hang on a minute. Let me switch cameras for a minute because I need to say this. One of my heroes when it comes to, I'll probably get emotional about this, but you know, that you're used to that. One of my heroes when it comes to mothers and art is Di, Packer Di. And I will tell you, I have never, as long as all the people that I have encountered everywhere, and, you know, whether it's in the different arenas of creativity that I touch, the classes I've been in or taught, I have never, ever run into another mother, who does with her children what Packer Di does with hers. And I just want to tell you and pat you on the back because I know you get exhausted. I know you want to just throw in the towel sometimes. Well, I'm going to ball too, Di, so there you go. And I wish I had done that with my own son, and I didn't. So those of you who have young children, I want you to take this as encouragement to get your children their own stuff. I know Larkspur Vicky does this with her grandchildren. Get them their own supplies, and don't get them crap. okay? Get them good stuff. Get them fun things. And, you know, if they wreck your stuff, buy some more. But don't, it's like, it used to frustrate me. It still does when people teach their children to sew and they buy them a piece of crap sewing machine because they're just learning. Well, that frustrates children. It doesn't matter whether it's sewing or art or whatever it is. It doesn't matter. Start your kids with some good stuff. You know, Prang watercolors are inexpensive, but they're decent. You know, they're good and they're pigmented, they're colorful. So start those. You know, teach your kids to work with good scissors. Teach your kids to work. And it doesn't have to be children, you know, your own kids. It could be grandchildren. It could be the neighbor kids, whoever it is, you know? I'm telling you. So I just want to say, to pack or die. Okay, so let's go back to this. Goodness. Yes, and pack or die has raised some amazing, she has two little artists and she has an older daughter who's in art school. Yes. Okay. Well, Copics, that's a whole other story. Yeah, that's a whole other story. All right, so here we go. This is a new book that came out. This is from Cloth, Paper, Scissors. I had been watching this. It finally arrived in my Barnes & Noble, and I did check, and they do have it available on Amazon, although you'll pay more, quite a bit more, on Amazon for an issue. But if you don't have any other way to get it, you know, at least you could get it. They also have it online, and Carrie's having allergies. Di, you're welcome. But they also have a downloadable version of this that you can get for your iPad or whatever. I'm telling you, I would not, personally, that doesn't do it for me. Personally, I want to have the thing. I want to have the thing in my hand, you know? And so I got my hands on a copy of it. I thought I would just show you just a little bit. If you like to doodle, and if you like Zen Tangle, Zen Doodle, this is a whole lot of eye candy, and it's got a whole lot of good stuff in it. Talks about supplies, talks about the artists, and a studio that, you know, I'll tell you, if that's all that her studio is, and if it's that neat all the time, I don't know. I don't have anything to say. But different ways. There are some step-out things. There are some pattern things. I mean, you know, you can see it stepped out. And I know you can order this directly from the Cloth, Paper, Scissors people because they did a whole big push on it before it came out. But this is interesting. This is Botticelli meets Artful Doodling. And I thought this was really interesting. So she's taking the creator, Barbara Finwall, is taking the artwork from the artist and then cutting the hair off. You can see here's the hairstyle, cutting it off, and then replacing it with doodling. And so here's some more examples. Anyway, interesting stuff. And da-da-da, here is a mandala. In case you haven't had enough mandala, she's calling it sand dollar, creating a mandala. And the interesting thing about this is the way she starts it. She starts it from the center. She starts with guidelines, but she does not start with the circle around it. She builds it from the middle out and ends up with the circle. So it's interesting. This one I thought was great because it's white on black and black on white on the same piece. I thought, now that's really fun. I should try that. That would be cool. Decked out con men, so it's altering decks of cards. Carrie, this seems like something that you would do. I don't know. I might be totally off base, but this just seems like something Carrie would get into doing. So, anyway, and there's tons more stuff in this book. The cost of it at the bookstore was $10. It was $9.99. And so it's very cool. I know the doodled hair was cool. Hello, Jerry. Nice to have you here. And if I haven't said hello to any of you, and if you're, well, I guess I could actually talk to you, couldn't I? If I haven't said hello to you and you're new here, make yourselves new, you know, tell us that you're new. I know Patricia was new today, which is great. Hi, Miko. And I'm so glad you're here. Yeah, Carrie's not, that's really, I thought that was something you might like. Okay, so let us, that's all the show and tell and all that stuff. And now we're not gonna get all weepy and allergy-fied and all that, because we're done with that. That's right, Angel. And Angel, I'm sorry I forgot your name, but you have to go to chapters. That's right. All right. So I thought, before we got into the little project, hi, Claire. Uh-huh. Sure, you're new. And Jay says that you can prime playing cards with plastic-friendly spray paint. Good information. You know, Jayza, can you prime it with spray gesso also? I didn't read the article, so I don't know. But I was wondering if you could do that. Maybe you know that too. Okay, so I thought, in honor of children, I would show you some kid art kind of stuff, right? And for inspiration. So here we go. Now this won't fit on the screen completely. This is kid art. It is a cat, in case you can't tell. The poor thing has lived a very long life. Very long life. Okay, JZ says she hasn't tried spray gesso. Okay, I was just curious. This is a kitty cat made of oil cloth, if any of you know what oil cloth is. It has a tail made, it's braided from yarn in yellow, red, and black. And it's painted with what? I have no idea. It's shiny paint. And it's a two-dimensional thing. It has been stuffed. It is coming apart. Right? It is coming apart. And it was made by me. I don't know when. And this would be why, people, this would be why I tell you to sign your work. And you will see some of the things I have to show you in addition to this. They're all signed and dated. Hi, Paige. You want to make sure that you sign and date your work. Anyway, this is probably created when I was about six, I'm gonna guess six or seven. The poor thing is coming apart. It's stuffed with what appears to be t-shirts or something. I don't even remember. But anyway, my mother kept it for 100 years and now I'm keeping it for the next 100. So, yeah. And this, just so you can see, another little thing. This was created by Claus Man, also known as my husband. This is walnut, I believe, and he carved it with a pocket knife way back in a very long time ago. I'm going to guess it was probably when he was in high school or junior high or, you know, something. So his proportions aren't perfect and so forth and so on, but who cares? You know? Who cares? And it's split, and hopefully it doesn't come apart, but he signed the bottom of it, and he put a date on it where he was just guessing how old he was. We were talking about that date last night because we were trying to figure out. I said, that date doesn't seem right to me. I said, I think the date's too old for you, and he started figuring, and oh, good grief. He can't even remember when our son was born, let alone, you know, when something happened a long time ago. But, you know, like how old he was. Time means very little to Claus Man. Very little. All right. So moving forward, we have the next generation. and I'm just setting stuff off to the side here. We have the next generation who came up, and some of you that might have seen the YouTube video that I did this week will have seen, did I show this on the YouTube video? Yes. So this is made by our son, who, if he's still in the chat, will be so excited. I have to read this. Claire says she found a vintage, Claire's from the UK. She says, I found a vintage cushion from the 30s and 40s, opened it up, and it was stuffed with knickers that had holes in and broken elastic, clearly used. I will never open a vintage cushion again. Oh, that's funny. So when our son was very small, and any of you in the chat, Race Man or Race Owen is my son, when he was very little, I don't know how old, because it's signed with his name, but it doesn't have, I think it has a 6, but I'm not sure. So he was very little, and he fashioned this out of mud from our yard. And I think he called this figure Pedro. It's never had anything done to it, and it's lasted a great long while. So I thought I would show that to you. Then fast forward quite a few years, and he was taking a class in high school, an art class. He had to have a fine arts credit, and so he took that. So this is a piece of, I would assume that it is, I don't know what it is. I'm assuming it was clay that was fired, but I don't truly know. But it has 2 holes in here, so it can be attached to the wall. I've never had it attached to the wall. I just have had it in my cabinet. So that was one of the pieces that he did. This was another one that he did. So if he's here, he might be able to give you more information. It's not, I don't think it's plaster. I think it's some kind of clay. As you can see the clay. But I don't know. Anyway, I love this one. Absolutely love this. Because it's a hand holding a cup. Okay. Oh, thanks. Thanks for the YouTube link there, Jean. Anyway, this I thought was great. I loved it. I love the patterning. I love having kid art in my life. So I thought I would show you. I'm going to show you a few other things too. This was some of his artwork, not the hearts and the metal piece, but this was some of his artwork. It was on a piece of fabric that I happened to find. I unearthed it one day when I was looking for some stuff, and I was like, when did he do this? I have no idea. And so I saved it. I rescued it. And then I used it to put on the cover of a composition notebook. I added the hearts. I did a little stitching on it. Clawsman created the butterfly for me. Let me see if I can show you the butterfly. So you can see that butterfly? That's all twisted and created by hand. Isn't that cool? So Clawsman did that. So I sewed it to the front. Because butterflies, as many of you know, are one of the things that really mean a lot to me. And then this was a part of this piece that he had done. Growth, and he obviously forgot the TH, so he stuck it in there, growth of the heart. I don't know how old he was when he did this, but I had to keep it. I did. I had to. And then I have a few other little pieces to show you. These won't fit under the camera, so we're just going to take a quick look at them. This was done in that same art class that my son took. Must be watercolor or maybe it's acrylic. I don't know. Anyway, we mounted it on foam core, so this is just mounted on foam core. And I mean, I didn't see any of this stuff when he was creating it. He just brought them home one day and they were all just sheets, you know, just plain old sheets of paper. And he was kind of sheepish about showing them to me. And I went, no way, you know, these are worthy of framing. And so we had some frame stock because we used to do custom framing. And so we put them in frames, and I have these on a display, hanging in a grouping on a wall in our hallway. So here's another piece, and I'm sorry about the reflection, but they're glass. And again, they're framed. So kid art, and you'll see it's signed and dated. Kid art, no matter how old or young the kid is, to me is very important to keep and encourage. And to honor the kids and say what you have done is beautiful and thank you for doing this and keep them creating. So here's another one. And I love them. I love them all. There's not one that I love the most. And this one goes, those are, the first three I showed you were horizontal. This one was vertical. And I also love this. So it was important to me that he felt honored. And it's recording, Di, so you can catch it again. So this was all, it's important to me that kids feel that their work is important. And that's one of the things that I really love about kid art. It makes them feel encouraged. So then we go from that to the grandkids. And I don't have a lot from the grandkids, but I have a few things from grandkids. So I thought I would show those to you that I kept. And as you notice, these are done at my house. And this was Christy, and it was done in 1998. So she was about 6 when she did this and has her little signature on it. You have a family portrait that Gracie drew and framed in the dining room. Ah, how nice, Di. That's wonderful. This one is really hard to see because it's very, very light. You're going to see this more in just a second. Also by Christy, this was in 2003, so it's signed and dated. That was something that was really important to me to have her do. And then I have a few other things that the boys did. There were three grandchildren in our family. So a few things that the boys did. These have been hanging on my refrigerator. They're yellowed. And but just to show you some of the critters, and this one had, he drew an apple, I think, on the back. So we have a creature and another creature, but it's important to have their signature. This was in 1993, and their signature is so amazing. You want to keep their signatures as well. And this little guy, he was really into drawing. This is the same kid. He was into drawing creatures and so forth. And this one is by the other grandson, and he likes to name things, so this was called, he liked calling this Crystal Lake. This is all done in crayon. And again, with what year he was in school and what date he finished it. And this one, I'm sure I will do something with in the future. This one has stars and all of that, and he named it Star Planet, so he wrote that on there. Again, he was in sixth grade. This is just on cheap drawing paper, so it's getting brittle, which is another reason that we want to do something with these things. And then this was done by Christy when she was a little bit older. She was in fifth grade, and that was her girl that she drew. So the first thing about kid art, you want to keep it, right? You can't keep it all. You can keep some of it. Oops, I need part of that. Pardon me while I bend over to get part of this back up here. Because we're going to now do something with it. All right. So I'm going to show you some of the ways, some of the things you can do just very quickly, that some of the things you can do with it, and then we're going to actually do something. So one of the things you can do is you can turn it into fabric, into an art quilt. So here's the art quilt. Deb says her kids made a quilt in kindergarten using crayons and wax paper, and the teacher turned them into a quilt. Oh, how lovely. Oh, that's great. That's cool. So this is using a combination of this little piece and this one. Okay, so and using this one and putting them all together and making this little art quilt. So that's what I did here, and I captured her signature exactly the way that she wrote it, or as close to the way she wrote it as possible. And turned it into fabric. So you can turn the artwork into fabric. You can turn it into using the same artwork as a basis for paper, which is what we're going to do today. So here's using the same little piece, turned it into paper. This is all jelly prints and this is all jelly prints. Well, there's a couple paste papers also. Barf. Debbie, I've been called worse. No worries. And then you can take, if you don't want to do the same thing over and over, you can take the piece, you can scan it if you have a scanner, and then print them out and use them as cards, as the basis of postcards, or to put on a greeting card or whatever. And then add a greeting to it, a handwritten greeting that looks kind of childlike. So you can do that. You can turn it into paper, which is what we're going to do here shortly. And what else do I have to show you? You can turn it into metal. You can do the artwork into metal. Uh-oh. I lost her hair. She went bald. I got to put her hair back on. I glued these with E6000 and my glue did not hold, so I gotta go back and do that. So there is done in metal. Now this is metal that's brass and copper and silver. So that's how she looks. So this is brass, copper, and silver that you can then use for chain, for charms or necklace. No, do not do that, Race Owen. He says he's going to register Barf Owen. Four letters of my name get butchered more than anything in the entire world. I don't know how those four letters can get so messed up. So we'll have to fix that, little girl. This is done in metal also, but this is not sawed. All of these pieces on this one were actually hand sawed out. Clawsman sawed these out for me. So each one of these is actual metal that's been sawed and filed and all that kind of stuff. This one we're going to do on stream in a week or so. And this is actually using a very lightweight metal. Show it to you up close here. He is, Joyce. He's getting back at me for showing his stuff. So this is done. See how shiny it is? This is done in a real lightweight metal, and I'll show you the process. We'll play around with that in a week or so. But this can be done with the metal and then glued on to the card. It says be happy, so it's just a little greeting card. And what else? Is there anything else? I don't think so. All right, so you can take the kids' artwork, kid art. I like to call it kid art. So you can use the kid art as the basis because the paper is going to go away. The paper is yellowing. It's getting brittle. It's getting ready to, you know, evaporate. Not really, but you know what I mean. This is just like, this is probably construction paper or something. It's not even good paper. And so they're getting ready to go away. I know it does remind you of gingerbread, doesn't it? And so this is a way to preserve the kids' art. Use it for a basis for something else. So today what we're going to do is we're going to turn it in. We're going to use the art and we're going to turn it into paper, preserve it in paper. So here are a couple of examples along with this one. Okay, so there's the one I just showed you. This is taking one of the flowers from her little art. Yes, you have to wait till next week. Yes. So this is taking one of the flowers from her artwork, and I've enlarged it, and I've turned it into a greeting card. So it just says smile, because who couldn't smile about that happy little flower? All of a sudden, I want to turn myself into Bob Ross. Happy little flowers. And this is, if you remember, it went on the floor where all of my stuff is living because it does. This was the kitty cat, all right, who is, again, disintegrating. But clearly, because my mother kept it all those years and I've kept it for the next bazillion years, it should be turned into something. And so I've created it, used this as the basis for this. So this kitty, I will show you up close here. So here's the kitty card, okay, up close so you can see it. Right, just like that. And down at the bottom it says meow, and that's written in copper, a copper pit pen. And then inside I added the message, meow means woof in cat, just because I thought it was funny. But that's the kitty cat. Bye, Vicky. Good to see you. So the kitty itself is done using a jelly print, clean off print. So this was when I was cleaning off all the paint from my jelly plate. And, you know, that's what pulled up. And it was perfect for me because it's kind of looking old and scraggly like the original. Okay. And so I liked that. And it was close to the same color. And then what else did I do? I took, you know, did the eyes and the nose as close to that as I could. I did the little, whatever these lines are. I'm assuming those were supposed to be the front paws of the kitty. I don't remember. It's too long ago. So I did those because those were done in red on the original. You see the red lines? The red swooshes. And then the collar, mimicked the collar. I put little whiskers on it just like that were on the original. And then I went back and I punched holes with a teeny tiny hole punch. So this is, well, I'll show that to you in a second. It's a tiny hole punch. And then I just used a double strand of pearl cotton and put it around the edge just like the original was. It's only one layer, but I did that all the way around. So it looks like it's been stitched together. And then I made the tail to mimic the tail that is on the original cat, which is yellow, red, and black. And I braided it and attached it to the back of the cat. So all the attachments on the back of the cat are just attached with scotch tape. And then when I glued it down, then the glue is holding all the rest of it. So that's where that came from, right? So I thought I would show you the process of how you can do this with paper. So the first thing you want to do is, let's say that you want to create, in the case of this card right here, I took the various pieces and parts from the artwork, and then I just created using pencil. I laid them down and I created them with pencil first, and I created my pattern, right? I just created the pattern based on the original artwork. This image right here is um It is the very same size as the one that's here. It looks bigger, but it's exactly the same size. So what you want to do is to take a piece of tracing paper. Let me see, do I have the, yes. So in order to capture this and get it exactly the way I wanted it, I took a piece of tracing paper. And this is tracing paper, in case any of you don't know what tracing paper is, because sometimes I've had questions about that. So this is a Strathmore tracing paper, and there's a link if you want to find out more information about it. And I can give you a link in the chat that you can actually click on in case you want to do that. And then you can just find out more information about it. So that'll give you a link to find out about the tracing paper. Tracing paper comes in different sizes. This one happens to be an 11 by 14 size. So there's the link. It's create.me/tracingpaperpad. That'll take you directly to it if you want to find out more about it. And it is, this one happens to be 50 sheets. And I think most of them come in about 50 sheet packets or tablets. So what I did was I put this on my tracing paper over the design. Now, because of the way that she did it, she drew it, and I don't know if the colors faded or, you know, exactly what. But in order to be able to see it, I used this inexpensive little light box. And I don't know whether you can are going to be able to see that. But by putting the tracing paper over the image, it shines through the paper, and then it allows me to do that. Now, you can also do this by, oops, try not to blind you guys. Put my hand over it. You can also do this by taping things up to a window. So you can do that as well. But, you know, the one thing that I've found is that I want to do this at midnight and or whatever, and there's no light. You can also take a clear piece of glass. If you have a glass coffee table, you can put a light under that. There's lots of ways you can do it without having to buy a light box. And this is a small one. It's only 6 by 9 inches. I will tell you, I reach for this thing a lot. Hi, Mitzi. Hi, Patty. I will tell you, I reach for this thing quite a bit because it works for fabric and paper and what have you, and whatnot, as our Dee Dee likes to say. So that's the first step, is make your tracing and decide if there's anything else you want to do. So I traced some of her flowers from her other piece on here and made the grass straight across just like she has it right here. Then, once I have my tracing made, then I took it to my inexpensive printer, okay? My inexpensive printer, put it face down in the printer and copied it. And so that's what I ended up with to get this. So that's what I ended up with. That's how I, my process. But the one thing you need, I find it's very helpful to have the tracing, the light, you need the overall structure, and then I like to have just a plain white copy. So you can do that. You can also scan it into your computer if you're good at scanning and doing things like that, and then you can adjust the size inside your computer if you want, or you can just adjust the size by copying it in different sizes, sizing it up, sizing it down to get what, you know, the size that you want. Okay, so here's what I have. I've taken some of her flowers. Here's the tracing of the cat. I've taken some of her flowers, and I wanted to make a cardstock pattern so that I have something with a little, this is too lightweight to trace around. And so what I did was I took a piece of plain old white cardstock, and I laid the flower on here like this, and you can tape it. We'll do that. You can tape it onto your cardstock, and the reason I'm doing this is just to get something that's a little heavier. I've already traced all these, but we'll do this one. So I just put a piece of tape so it doesn't slip too much. And then use a piece of graphite paper. And that is what this is. And again, if you want to know more about graphite paper, I'm going to show you how to use it. But if you want to know more about it, I have a link here for you. So that'll show you what the graphite paper is. But it's this paper that once you put it down on your surface, if you put it here and you've got the right side down, you can make a mark and it will transfer down onto your surface. So you want to, when you work with this, you can use a ballpoint pen, you can use a pencil, you can do anything you want to transfer the design. I tend to like using a stylus, and so there is a set of styluses, I don't know. Anyway, a set of styluses from Martha Stewart. If you want to take a look at those, you're welcome to do that. This gives you more, gives you some options in case you don't have a stylus. If you have one, you're all set. Or you can use a ballpoint pen, doesn't matter. I like using the stylus because it doesn't mark up my pattern. So I've just slipped the graphite under there, and then I'm just gonna draw my little, go around the lines. And here's what I need to do on this. I need to break these shapes apart. So I'm gonna do the outer flower petal out here, okay? Then I'm gonna lift this up and I'm gonna just move it to another, a fresh little place. This is why I don't typically tape these down. Okay, so I'm gonna move it to another spot. Slip the graphite under, and now I'm going to trace the center of my flower. And the reason for doing this is just because it will give me the truest rendition of their art possible. And so then I'm going to trace in a different place, I'm going to trace the stem and the leaves. Just like that. So the more accurate and careful you are, the better you're going to get your little flower to be, or little girl or kitty or whatever it is you are doing. So then what I do is just take the cardstock and cut the various pieces out. Now, if you're trying to be, if you're trying to keep the child's art as true as possible, then you want to be accurate every step of the way as much as you possibly can. And so this is fussy cutting. But the great thing about taking kids' art and doing this is you can make them feel important. And it doesn't matter how old they are or how young they are, everybody likes to have what they create recognized and honored. So if you don't have any kids in your life now, there's surely some kids in your neighborhood or somewhere else or at church or, you know, somewhere that you might run into. And if all else fails, you can search online. You'll find all kinds of images for kid art, and you can do some cool stuff with that as well. Okay, so I'm going to just see if I can get an accurate cut. I just find it easier. There's a million different ways to do anything, but I find that it's easiest if I have something with an edge on it to trace around. And so if you like that, if you're like me and you like doing it that way, this is a great way to accomplish this relatively easily. It takes a little bit of time, it's a little fiddly, and the more pieces you have, like that cat that I did, that took a while to do. It didn't take forever because I started it after 10:30 last night. and finished it. It probably took me an hour and a half to do, and that was with figuring out what I wanted to do. And usually kids' drawings and images are pretty simple, especially when they're young. As they get older, of course, they get more and more elaborate. So there are our little pattern pieces, okay? So we've got the flower center and the petal and stem. And then if you keep your tracing available, you know, your like your master pattern, and remember and kind of look at it and go, okay, which one, which flower was this? See, I've already confused myself, and this is typical. This one. Okay. So I like to use, when I'm doing this stuff, I like to use the Sharpie pens. So I'm going to label this flower number 3. So I know that that is, that all those pieces go to this flower. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to use some paste papers. And so I've created some paste papers. So I think what we'll do, actually, let's create a sky and a, let's see, what do I have here? Just looking, peoples, just looking. Looking through my stash of stuffs here. Let's see. Okay. So what we're going to do is, this is a black, just a piece of black cardstock that I've create or that I've cut out. And I'm thinking I'm going to use, it's a pre-made card. I'm thinking that we might mat it with this black on top of this green, because I think that might be fun. But I think what we'll do is we'll make the flower, or the background for the flower, smaller than that. So let's see what we can do. So if we made it, it's 4.5, so if we make it 4 inches, 4 by 6, I think is what we'll do, 4 by 6, then that will give us something that will, you know, be inside the black, okay? So we need some blue for the sky. We're going to make sky and ground. So I'm looking here for what I think might be pretty sky. So we'll do this for the sky, okay? All right, so I'm making this up as I go, people. Just making this up as I go. So this is some jelly prints. Nothing fabulous. All I did was just get the paints out and did a little bit of texturizing, because all I was after was color. So we're going to come over here, and I'm going to give myself a straight edge. And in my world, I don't care if it's perfect. So I'm just going to get rid of some of the paint to begin with. Or some of the white, you know, just give myself an edge to go with. All right, so we said 4 by 6. So let's just cut this off. And we don't need to have 6, we need to have more like 4.5. Okay, so then what that's going to do is that's going to give me, we're going to build this and then we're going to put it together. Okay, so that's going to be the sky. And then we need some grass. So we have some green here. And then we have, yeah, I kind of like this one. This will be fine. So again, I'm going to just cut off some of the excess stuff here. And we need a strip that is four, what'd I say? Four? Yeah. So we need a strip. Of course, I made this hard for myself. That's okay. Why not? So we're going to do four. And we may have to trim it down a little bit, but you know. Let's get rid of some of this stuff here. Just. And basically, okay, there's my four, so I want like 1.5 inches. We'll see whether I figured right. Math is not my strong point, but I have more paper. Okay, so this is gonna be our sky. This is gonna be our ground. See, I told you math was not my strong point. It's 1/4 inch too wide. Yep, of course it is. Because I made it 4.25 instead of 4. Okay, so we have our sky and our ground. Not looking too bad, not looking too bad. Okay. So I thought what I would do is I would edge around the edges. I'm just using a pit marker. And although maybe it's not outlined all the way around, maybe the child didn't outline it all the way around, maybe they did. When you do this kind of thing, make sure that you work with the bulk of the pen away from the right side of your artwork. If you do it this way and you slip, which invariably happens, you will slip right up onto your artwork. Well, I hope that this little series that we're doing will encourage you to encourage the children in your life. I really do, because that's the point. All right, let's sticker down, shall we? So I'm just going to use, you could use glue, you could use score tape, you could use whatever you want to, but actually, you know what we're going to do? We're going to put these together first. And then we're gonna stick the whole thing down. Okay, so we're gonna do like this because I just think it'll be easier. And I'm all about whatever makes it easier for me. So I'm gonna line these up. I remember as a kid watching Captain Kangaroo. Okay, all right, so, you know, any of you that remember Captain Kangaroo, raise your hands. And they were always putting stuff together with tape. All right, so we have this tape together. That at least makes it controllable as one piece. So I think we're good to go. So that's going to be our sky and our ground. And I apologize if this gets... the tape runner gets in your way or gets real out of focus, but you know, it's a big honking thing. You could use glue on this if you want, but I think we're going to use tape. And then I'm going to put some right here where this join is and a little bit down the middle. Just a little bit here and there. Artie Dar remembers. Of course you do, Dar. Mr. Green Jeans. Grandfather Clock. All right, so this is the part I'm the least good at doing. So we will see. You know, it's not too bad. It's not perfect, but it's not too bad. It's kid art. And then this part's gonna go on here. That's not looking too bad, people. It's not looking too bad. So let's see if we can put this on here. All So the card's going to go this way. So whatever you do, don't stick it on this way or you'll be reading your card backwards. Oh, and Bunny Rabbit. I know. All right. So we're going to see. All right, so we have the basis for our little note card, right? Now we need to build our flower. So we know what we have, the sky, we know we have the ground, and so now we have three pieces for our flower. So I have some leftover yellows from jelly plate, round jelly plate things, and so I'm going to use my little cardstock pattern. I'm going to use the Sharpie pen. This is the black Sharpie pen. Happy the Clown. Oh, Dar was on Happy the Clown show out of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Oh, how fun. How fun. Not everybody can say that. We had a local kids program here. That I forgot the name of it. Anyway, I was on that one time as a little kid. Oh, thought I was a star. Thought I was a star, I tell you. Woo! Memories, huh? But I like using the Sharpie pen for doing this. You could use lots of other things. I find it not a very expensive pen, and I find that it dries pretty quickly on most surfaces. It dries really well on the tracing paper also. So how about if we make a pink flower? Shall we? Yes, we shall. So again, this is just jelly plate stuff. And we're going to pick a spot. Doesn't really matter because not much of it's going to be visible. Let's see if we can just like, well, we'll just take this place right here. It doesn't matter. All right. If you hold your pen vertically, you'll get a thinner line and hug the cardstock. That's a good thing. And before I go any further, if I want lines on my flower, like the flowers that she created, this is the one we're doing. You see how she drew the petal lines into the center? So maybe we'll do that on this one. Because it's real hard to do that later. So if you want that, you need to put that in there now. All right, now we need a green stem. So this, in order for this to be a little different from this one, I'm just pulling out a different green here. And we're going to pick a spot on here somewhere. Doesn't really matter. I'm just after a contrast against the rest of it. So we'll just pick a spot here. And again, draw around it. Now, you can do this in pencil if you want. But I kind of liked having the little black outline. Okay, so there we have it. Now what we have to do is cut the pieces out. Now, when you have things that overlap, such as the flower petal is going to need to overlap the stem, it's a good idea to give yourself a little extra up there. So that's what I'm not going to cut off. This bit at the top, I'm going to just keep cutting. And I'm going to endeavor not to cut off the black line. However, I'm going to go around it and edge it with the pit pen again. just to get rid of the white paper edge. So, you know, it doesn't have to be perfect. Remember, we're doing a kid's thing. We're preserving, pardon me, we're preserving and using kid art. Bye, Joyce. Good to see you. So, yeah. So, if any of you do any art based on children's artwork, I would love for you to tweet pictures to me, because I'd love to share them. And I might even put them on the website if you would allow me to do that. If we have a place to do that. I don't even know if we have a place to do that yet. Is Rain here? Hi, Rain. Rain's losing track. Well, Rain, you're going to have to go back and watch the recording. Because I bet you'll like it. I bet you'll have fun. All right, so we're going to cut our flower out. When you do things in metal, like I did the little necklace or charm, it's actually better if you solder those pieces together. You saw that the hair came off that one, and that was because I used glue, which I thought would hold it, but I didn't use a very thick coat of glue. So those pieces, if they're done in brass and copper and silver, those are actually better if they're soldered together. The challenge you have is that you're using different metals that the solder melts at a certain temperature, but it may not, you know, you may have some differences of temperature between the metal and the solder. And the anytime you mix metals like that, it can be a little bit of a challenge. So sometimes you just have to do some experimentation with things to see what works and what doesn't. All right, so there's our flower petals, and then we have our little flower center. Yeah, I glued it quite a while ago, but I think honestly the problem is probably that I didn't have enough on there, because I was trying to be careful that it didn't ooze out, you know, so I think I probably didn't use enough. Or the other option could have been that perhaps the metal wasn't as clean as it needed to be. Because that's another thing you got to do. Have it clean. Okay, so let's go back to our pattern. And you want to come back, and if you want to be true to the artwork, you want to see, you know, you can tell that that's not the right way. So you can just kind of play around and reposition it so you go, oh yeah, that's the right way that it goes. And the center went kind of like this, kind of like that. Okay. And so this is where I decide that I'm going to turn to tacky glue, but let me edge this first. Okay, so I'm going to edge this. Just because it makes it a little bit neater. Now, I realize we're working with kid stuff, but there's no reason it has to be sloppy. So this again is just to get rid of the edge of the cardstock, which is white, and you know, it just makes it look a little better. Okay, and then once again, figure out where, what direction it went. Hello, Miss Vicky. Hello, Miss Bridgeton Cheryl. Nice to have you guys join in the fray. So So a lot of this started from art in the park and seeing all the kids and how excited they were at art in the park last weekend. And also, it also came from the fact that I'm part of a group that is doing a they're doing a collaborative quilt project. And I am not a quilter as such. And so because I'm part of the group, I have to participate. All right, we're gonna do it just like this because that's how a kid would draw it, okay? They would draw it, you know, sticking up. So that's how we're gonna do it. So the first thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna glue the center into my flower, okay? So I'm just using tacky glue, and then I'm going to pull this off because I don't want to take a chance of messing up the background yet. Put a little glue. I'm going to put my little flower on there, on the stem. Hold it for a minute. It sets up pretty easily, pretty quickly. And you also have a little bit of time to adjust things. So if you need to tilt or turn things a little bit. Now, I'm not really a quilter. No, I'm not. This is a group of art quilters, and yeah. By comparison to this group, I would be a dabbler. I would be a dabbler. So I'm going to add some glue to the back of my little piece, and then I'm going to spread it with my finger. Now, until everything is completely dry, this is a bit vulnerable. So if something comes apart, just be patient with yourself, because I'm gluing a whole, you know, series of little things together here. And I'm going to lay it down and just kind of eyeball. It's kid art, so you don't need to worry too much about it. Now, if you want to stay completely true to the kid art, then leave it at that. If you want to add some other things to it, you certainly could. So you could add words, you could add little birds in the sky. I'm feeling a little bird here and there, so I think we have to put a bird on it. So we might have to have some little birdies up in the sky. And we might need to have a word down here. So, what word do you think we should put on it? Or phrase? Or what have you? I'm going to see what you guys think we should do. Thanks, Cheryl. So let me know what you think we ought to do. This is when you get to vote. So this is when you get to tell me what you want me to do. Hope, okay. Cheryl wins. All right, so I'm gonna write this in, what is this color? Copper. Always check to make sure that your pen is good shape. And I think we'll write it over here. So let's see, do we wanna do that? We wanna go over here. Mm-hmm. We'll just write it over here. Okay, so we put the word hope on it. And I'm not going to do anything that's any more. Bridgeton, Cheryl, what I'm doing is I'm using children's art as a basis for making other art like this. So there's all kinds of things. When you go back and watch the recording, you'll see what it is that we were. What we did. Okay, so there is this little card. Then you could add, you know, a quote inside or whatever else. Now, if you want this to dry perfectly flat, you need to put a piece of parchment or wax paper over it and then put something on it and then let it sit. Now, you could ink the edges of the card. You could do, you know, you can get as elaborate as you want to, right? So it is 2:52. Would you like to do another one? Or are you tired of it? I'll let you, again, I'm feeling a generous mood today, so I'll let you vote. Do you want to go? Are you tired of it? Or do you want me to do another one? You Are My Sunshine was your kid's favorite. You like them? I think they're fun. I think they're a lot of fun. And the other cards, I have now managed to lose them. They're here somewhere. Dar says she wants more. Here they are. Here are the other ones. So this one is one of the other little flowers. You see on this one I didn't add the extra petals like they were connected into the center, so it has a different look. So that's a different one. Same little girl, same artwork. And then here is the kitty, inspired by the stuffed cat. Meow means woof in cat. All right, so, and then here is the little girl. These are by the same little girl. This was by me as a little girl. So this is the basis for this. Dar, you're back. Dar is back. All right, so we need another one. All right. Let's see what else do we have here. You want to see the cat? You want me to do the cat? Maybe we'll do a cat. I don't know how long this will take. It shouldn't take as long as it did the first time. Let me find the cat parts. Here we go. Here's cat parts. All right. We'll do another green cat. Because after all, aren't all cats green? I don't have this one drawn off. I don't know what I did with the pieces and parts to this one. But you want to see the girl. Well, maybe I do. Wait a minute. Let me see. Do I have that drawn off? I don't think I have that one drawn off, Sandra. I don't know what I did, how I did that one. I don't know how I did it. It's too long ago. I've slept since then. So we'll just do a cat just because. Because I can. And because you're at my house. All right, so this is the jelly print. You can see that's where the cat came from the first time. This was a clean-off jelly print, so we're just going to lay the cat down here, and we're just going to draw a cat. Again, this was done with the cardstock. My pattern is cardstock. I'm drawing around it with a black Sharpie pen in fine. The fine point. All right. And this kitty, I don't think I cut these out, so we're going to cut them out. I'm not quite sure what it, I tell you, after I sleep for a while, it all, I have to reinvent it. Left and right. So I know which eye is which. All right, so let me go around this eye and cut this out. Because they are different shapes. I'm gonna try and stay true. And this one, the whiskers, I'm not going to do out of paper. This one, the whiskers, I'm going to do in paint because it will be infinitely easier, and it would be easier to do the little kitty mouth in paint. And maybe we'll do that on this one, huh? We'll add the detail stuff in paint on this one, because that'll be something different than the first one. Okay, so we have the left and the right eye. And those are done in that kitty's eyes were yellow. Yes, they were yellow. So we're going to use these little left and right. And I'm going to pick a real yellow spot in this jelly print. So there's one eye. And here's the other eye. And now we cut them out. I am fussy cutting. I am. All right, people, here we go. We're going to cut some eyes out. Now, when you're using jelly prints to do things like this, you know, you get little bits and pieces of crud that pull up from other layers. So sometimes you look at it and you go, oh, I wish it didn't have, like there's a little tick in here of some other color. So you either decide that you can live with the additional colors or you decide you can't, and then you just draw around again, cut it out again. And so there are our left and right eyes. I'm sorry, Robin. I don't mean to put you to sleep. All right, just to make it easier so I don't have to deal with this big hunk of paper, I'm going to chunk it out. So we're going to chunk it out. Be easier to cut out, and you can choose to leave the black line on or take it off, it doesn't matter. Because in this case we're going to actually stitch around it. I know, stitch, but believe me, this kind of stitching anybody can do. And this, one of the sponsors just woke up from his nap and he's decided he's been in there long enough, so if you hear him, ignore him, okay? Don't anybody give him any sympathy because he is quite fine in his room. He is quite fine. He may not be content, but he is fine. So are you getting any ideas from this about things you could do with kids' art that might, the kids that might be in your world? Because we're going to explore several different ways that you can interpret kid art for your own art. It doesn't even have to be, your intention doesn't even have to be to preserve the kid's art. Maybe your intention is to use their art or random art from somewhere, kid's random art that you find somewhere, and you might use it as a source of inspiration for your own work. Not that art has to be work by any means. All right, so there you go. We have a cat and we have two eyes. Now before I get the glue out here, I'm going to punch the holes. So this is what I'm using for the hole punch. This is a We Are Memory Keepers. What is this, 16th inch hole punch. And it has a little door here that allows you to be able to see in there, which is incredibly difficult. So I just slide that thing out. It's easier for me to see what I'm doing if I don't have that little window thing in the way. You can see the hole right there. Now, I don't go around here and mark the holes. And I got lucky the first time. We're going to see if I get lucky again this time. So I just kind of guess, basically, where it is close to the edge. And then I find the hole, and then I just kind of move down the line and make the holes. So it takes a minute to go punching all these little holes. But it was nice because when they were punched, can you see how they're punched? Put some black behind it. Maybe you can see it. All right, I know I have more than that. Here it is. Can you see the holes there? Oh, Dar made kids art embroidery samplers. Oh, that's nice. So you can see the holes there. It's nice to have the little round holes because you know that they're big enough to get the thread through. I'm going to use pearl cotton. Now I'm having trouble seeing the hole. So you just kind of go around, and the holes in the original little cat weren't evenly spaced necessarily. So if they're not evenly spaced on this, oh, our kitty needs a collar. Yes, and we will have to cut that out of black, or we'll have to paint it in black. Maybe we'll paint it. Maybe I'll paint it. I gotta get the black out anyway, so maybe we'll just paint it. So just going around the edge and just punching holes, hoping that I'm somewhere close to about the same distance from the edge. Yeah, that's all right. Can you hear the sponsor? Complaining. Complaining. Yes. You don't have to have this tiny little hole punch, but it makes it easier when you do the stitching around the edge if you have the holes already punched. You could do it with a pokey tool. You could poke the holes with a pokey tool. Just in the end, it makes it faster if you poke, if you've punched the holes ahead of time. Now he's changed his meow. He tries complaining, and then he changes it to a please. Would you let me out, please? Please? That one got really close to the edge. That's close enough. Okay. So then you can just slip this back in if you choose to keep it in there. Get rid of all your little confetti because it's nasty. Because it's nasty. Who wants that around? Okay. Let's go ahead and I'm going to go ahead and stitch the edge first. Just because I can. So I'm using pearl cotton. And it is a number 5 pearl cotton. And this had a knot in it, so we're going to get rid of that piece. And I did a double thread because I wanted it to be kind of nice and, you know, have a heavier look to it. So I'm going to take, oh, maybe 18 inches doubled. So it's about a yard that I doubled. And a tapestry needle. So I'm going to use the littlest one I have that will accommodate the thread. Threading the needle. I may have chosen one that's slightly too small, a hole, an eye for the thread. It worked last night, it should work today. All right, there we go. So I'm just doubling the thread, okay? I'm not gonna put any knots in it. And I'm just gonna pick a spot to begin. It doesn't make any difference what spot I pick. Let's see, do I wanna do this or do I wanna, no. We're gonna change our mind because we can, and I'm gonna paint the collar on first. So let me get some black paint and red paint, because we'll go ahead and we'll just paint the details on. So let me be right back. I need to get my water jug. A fine little paintbrush. And a paper towel. And a palette thing. Just to have some place to put the paint. So just using some black craft paint and some red craft paint. I don't think I like this color red. And we'll use this one. Okay, so just to give myself a fighting chance to get things where I want, I'm going to use the one I already did, because why not? It's already done. And put the collar on the kitty. Right about there. Okay, so we got that. And then I don't know what the significance of this shaped nose was. There must have been some sort of significance. So, it's getting quite vocal in there. The sponsor's getting restless. In case anyone doesn't know, the sponsor is a, there are two of them behind door number one. In case you weren't here earlier. Now, the first time I did this, I did it all paper. This time, we're going to take a shortcut and we're just going to put it in with paint. You could use markers if you prefer pit artist pens or what have you. Probably the pit pens would be the best. Okay. So while I have the black in my hand, I need to put the little eye pupil thing for the eyes here. Okay, and remember that you're doing it like a cat and like a kid. You're not doing it like an adult. You like his voice. You should live with him, Rain. You should live with him. You should live with him. His voice, there's a reason that the sponsors live in the studio and don't live in the whole house. Okay, then this kitty has whiskers that are quite short, and they go kind of like this. And kind of like this. Okay, so there are the parts of the cat up there. Then they have these red lines down here that I'm assuming were meant to create the suggestion of front legs. But I don't really know. Okay, and that's all there is to that. So we're gonna hit it with, is Ashley here? Oh, there she is. Hi, Ashley. Nice to see you. If you guys haven't been over to Ashley's channel to see all the stuff she's been cranking out, my word. My goodness. Okay, that's dry enough. Dry enough. Should get this old yucky water thing out of the way here. Okay, now let's go back to the yarn that we're doing a moment ago. And it doesn't matter where you start at all. But come in to the back, and then I just took a piece of tape and just tape the ends into the cat's back. That way it doesn't want to pull through and you don't have to deal with knots. And then just go around from the bottom to the top. And because the holes are all punched, you just go, just like when you were a kid, if you ever did sewing cards. Anybody remember sewing cards? And just stitch around your kitty. And you kind of want the stitches to angle around the edge. Bridgeton Cheryl says she still has sewing cards. I think every kid had sewing cards at one point or another in their life. So this kind of takes you back to that earlier days, shall we say. If you run out of thread, you just end it on the back, put a piece of tape on it, put in a new piece, tape it, keep on going. So on and so on and so on. It's not hard. And if your red isn't as red as you think it ought to be, well, you can come back and make it redder with a marker on top of it. You know, use a pit marker or something. Or add another color of paint on top of it if you want. But having those holes punched really helps, and it does mimic the original little artwork too. It is meditative, it really is. Okay, so I'm going to end this thread here. Put another little piece of tape add another little piece of thread and finish it up. Make sure you don't tape over any of the holes, because if you tape over a hole, that's not so good. Rain likes to bind books because she finds that to be a very zen-like thing for her to do. This is pearl cotton. You find it, usually find it in about the same section you find embroidery thread, but it's actually pearl cotton, and you find it in different weights, and this is probably a number 8 because that's usually what I use. It comes in number 5 and number 8. Well, it comes in other numbers as well, but those are the two that I normally will grab. Okay, so I've just taped on another little piece, and I'm just going to finish it up. Finish the stitch. Okay, and then I'm going to tape it to the back, cut it off, and it's all stitched around the edge. Bye, Zandra. Thanks again for the beautiful pocket letter. Very sweet of you. Okay, so let's put our little kitty's eyes on. So may not be exactly like the first one, but you know, we're doing it on stream. It's a fun kitty, isn't it? It is a fun little kitty. Okay, so there's our funny little kitty. And so while that glue is setting up, let's do a tail. So I'm going to use, you don't have to make a very great long tail, but you need to make it longer than you anticipate making it, because some of it does get taken up in the braiding, and also you want enough to be able to tie a knot at the end. So braid a little bit more than you think you're going to need. And I doubled the thread. So I've got yellow and red and black, because that's what the original kitty had. And we want to do it like that. We want to be, you know, similar to the original. Doesn't have to be exact, but, you know, more or less. And then it just makes it easy, I think, if you just take the three, because it's doubled. Just take the end up here, and just to help give yourself a fighting chance, and just knot them together, okay? And then I need to have something that's going to hold it for me, so I'm going to use my tiny little paperweight. My tiny paperweight. And I'm going to separate the colors. So I want to divide it into three sets of two, and just braid like you would braid hair. Alright, so it's just like you're braiding hair. Now it's not going to look real pretty up there at the top, and that's okay, because we're not going to, that's why you're making a piece longer than you intended to make. So just always take the outside strands and bring them to the middle. And don't make it too terribly tight, because if you do, you're going to end up twisting and carrying on. So you just kind of take your time. You can make the nicest braid that you wish to make. This braid is going to be kind of funky because I'm trying to hurry. Because it's 3:22, people. It's 3:22 here, which is probably a completely different time in your part of the world. Especially if you're watching a recording, who knows when it could be that you're watching, but it's 3:22. We've been chatting away here for quite a while. So I just braided this until I was tired of braiding or ran out of thread. Take your pick. So, run out of thread or get tired of making the braid. But the first part, the first section up here at the top is not so usually so great. So, you know, that's why I go a little further. The dogs are getting restless. They're starting to move around. That must mean they're tired of me streaming. We know the sponsors are, because they've already made that abundantly clear. Okay, so pretty much we're at the end of the thread. So I'm gonna undo my paperweight. And I'm going to tie an overhand knot, as I need to stop the braid. Okay, so I'm going to stop the braid right there. And I'm going to cut the little ends. So we have a little end on the tail. Right there. And then we're going to decide how exactly we want the tail to go. Let's say we want the tail to go there. So, yeah, this is not bad up here, but we're going to take this end, take the knot out up here. Because I don't want to put a great big honking knot on the back of my little cat, don't you know? So we're gonna put the cat tail right there, turn it over, tape it down. I'm telling you, I remind myself of Captain Kangaroo right now with all this tape I'm using. All right, so there is our completed cat. So now we get to decide how we want this cat to live. So I'm wondering what this cat would look like if we did that and if we did this. I think that could be kind of cute on there. So I say let's do it. What do you say? You don't get a vote. Too late. I decided. Now, if you want to get all fancy, you can ink around the edges, and you can do all kinds of stuff on the mat. But I'm not going to get fancy. These, again, are just pre-done cards. So we'll see how... Let's see if I can live dangerously, and maybe... Not too bad. Not too bad. Bye, Vicky. Thanks for coming. We're almost finished. All right, so there's that. And now we're going to put the kitty on here, and we're going to swing his tail up like so. All right, so let's put some glue on the kitty's backside. Now, when you do this, I found with the first one, it was easiest to just simply glue in the middle of the kitty. So away from those holes, because I didn't want the glue oozing up through the holes. And then after I got it to where it was fairly dry, then I went back and I added glue in places where I thought it might need a little extra something something. All right, because I don't mind if it kind of sticks up off the paper a little bit. Now, I will come back later and I'll put a little glue under the feet and under the ears just to make sure that everything is gonna stay where I want it to stay. And I'll decide where it is I want the tail, and I kind of like the tail coming up and, you know, kind of wrapping around. Don't put very much, don't need much. Put the little tail there. And again, this needs to have weight put on it so that it can dry, and then go back after it's pretty dry, then go back and add some more glue here and there under the edges. But let's do the meow one more time. So we'll go. With some dots, and then we'll come inside and we'll say, meow means woof in cat. And so we will let that be this little card. So I'm going to let it completely dry, then go back and add a little bit more glue here and there, and it's all done. So there you go. Do you guys like that? So that's how you take kids' art as your basis, as your inspiration, and you turn it into other pieces of art. And in the process of doing that, you preserve the art of the child, and you also can say to that child, I think your art is beautiful. Right? I think your artwork is beautiful. So there you go. So we have several examples of different ways of making cards. Of course, there's lots of other things that I showed you earlier, different ways to use the artwork in different ways. So what do you think? You liked it? Oh, good. Good. I'm glad you did. That's great. Okay, I will set this stuff aside. We'll let the sponsors come out, because the sponsors, you know, are not going to be denied camera time, for goodness sakes. No way. And we will continue next week with transforming kid art in a different way. Now, don't forget that you can take the art that you've created. Like, this is the one that's all created in pieces, and then I scanned it and copied it and printed it out, put it on some black, and then it is the basis for another card. So you don't have to create it every time. You can use it as a basis for, do the art, you know, recreate it once and then make multiples and so forth. All right. So let me get the sponsors, because we know, prepare yourselves, they will make a charging entrance more than likely. Whoa, there he is. Sponsor number one. Come here, buddy. Are you coming up to say hello? Well, good. I'm glad that you enjoyed it. I really am glad you found it to be valuable and fun. Most of all, I just want you to have fun doing it. That's the biggest thing, just having fun. I do have to say, I like that color combination. Come here. Are you coming up? What, are you coming up? Huh? Well, come here. They want to see your old face. I don't know why. I don't know why, but they like to see the sponsor's face. Yep, they always want to see that sponsor face. Yes, they do. All right, there it is. This is Chance. Charlie, are you coming up? Come here. Yep, here he comes. Come here. Whoa. Okay. And so, if they will cooperate with me, here we go. And so, from my house, wrangling said sponsors to your house, I hope you have a wonderful weekend. I hope that, hello, Charlie. I hope that you get some inspiration, get inspired by some of the kids in your world, whoever they might be. And make some art. Get creative, huh? Get creative. That's what it's all about. Because, you know, after all, it is easy. Just do it, huh? All right, I'm going to stop the recording. Thanks for joining me. Thank you very much. I'm so glad everyone was here today. Hope you have a super wonderful weekend. So we're going to stop recording, and I will see you next week, same time, same place. So I'll see you then.